Thank you for joining us today for weekly worship in the Word at the Palace of Praise. You are now in the pre-service lobby. Here you can chat with others while waiting for service to begin, give through our online giving, or send us a prayer request. We encourage you to engage with us online during the service. The Palace of Praise worship service will begin in about 15 minutes. Thank you so much for joining us today on the Palace of Praise live stream. Don't forget, you can give your weekly tithes and other gifts online through the link in the video description below. This is a secure way for you to give tithes to us while on the go. If you have questions regarding online giving, please contact us by email. Contact us at palaceofpraise.com. The Palace of Praise worship service will begin shortly. Thank you so much for joining us today for the Palace of Praise live stream. If you have a prayer need today, we encourage you to leave it in the comments section of this video. Your church family would love to join with you in prayer for your needs. If you have a private prayer request, please click the prayer request link in the video description. Our live worship service will begin shortly. Thank you so much for joining us today for the Palace of Praise live stream. If you are new to the Palace of Praise, please take a moment to fill out a digital connect card. It's located in the video description below. We would love to know more about you and your family. Our Palace of Praise live stream will begin shortly. It's almost time for Palace Worship. Who's excited? I know I am. While we're here, let's chat for a few seconds. While we're waiting for the stream to begin, why not tell us a little bit about you or your family? Fill out a digital Connect card located in the link in the description. Did you know that you can pay your tithes online? There's a link in the description of this video where you can go and securely pay your tithes and offerings. And lastly, if you have a prayer request today, please reach out to someone. You can leave it in the comments section of this video or go to the video description section and click on the prayer request link. That's it. Simple as that. Connect, tithe, pray. Church is about to begin. Come on, get excited.
Good morning, Palace family.
Good morning. We want to welcome you to the Palace of Praise. If you're a visitor here with us, if you'll go ahead and start making your way to your seat. My name is Marcus Selvage. My wife, Sarah Selvage. We're thankful and happy that you're here and that we could all see through the pollen coming this morning. Who's on allergy medicine? Right, yep, here you. It's like laid out all on the counter at our house, so. Thank you for coming. We want to welcome you.
Yes, we're so glad you're here this morning. If you're a visitor, we want to take just a moment to give you a special shout out. Thank you for spending your Sunday with us. If you would, take a moment to fill out that information card. It's in the seat back in front of you. Fill that out. It's just a way for us to get to know you a little bit better. And when you're finished, you can put those in the offering boxes that are at the end of all the aisles. I also want to give a special shout out to any men out there who their wives are gone to retreat this weekend and you have wrestled those kids and you're at church on time. Good job, you've made it. And so we're so glad you guys are here. If you'll take a moment now, you can look at the screen and see what's happening now. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. I'm Cindy.
And I'm Mindy. If you're watching online, we're thankful you joined us as well. Here are a few upcoming events you might be interested in.
The Keenagers are having a Spring Fling potluck dinner on Friday, April 19th in the Metro at 6 p.m. If you plan to join in the fun, you can sign up in the Keenagers class.
Janice Watkins, president of Abigail Association in El Salvador and author of How to Get All Things We Want, will be with us on May 5th in the p.m. service.
There will be a baptism on Sunday, April 28th in the PM service. You can register to be baptized on the Palace of Praise Church app.
Attention all golfers, get your team together and join us for the golf tournament on Saturday, May 11th at Ozark Ridge Golf Course. It will be a four-person scramble and will start at 8 a.m. The cost is $75 per player and $5 mulligans. Sign up at the Ministry Center in the foyer. Contact Pastor Josh for information at josh@palaceofpraise.com.
All ladies are invited to a drop-in shower for Amanda Cates as we celebrate her upcoming marriage to Keith Brogie. The shower will be in the Metro on Saturday, May 4th from 1 to 3 p.m. They are registered at Walmart.
Pastor Eric Petrie from City Gate Church in Lebanon, Ohio will be joining us on Sunday, May 19th to continue the Fresh Voice series. Make plans to join us for these services.
That's it for now. If you'd like to stay connected with us during the week, view current events, get prayer requests on the prayer wall, and more, you can scan the code on the screen to download the Palace of Praise Church app.
You can also visit our website for updates on current and future events.
My spirit literally about a minute ago, but my favorite verse is Romans 8:18, and it says, "Yet I consider that our present sufferings are not worthy of comparing to the glory that he will bring forth to us later." If you are going through something right now, I just want to give this to you to maybe give hope, but joy is coming. King Jesus is on the way to rescue you from all the troubles of this life, and he is going to be on a throne, and we are going to glorify him together. Amen. It is so good to be back with each and every one of you this morning. This morning, we would like to remind you, as always, that you can continue in your giving of your tithes and offerings by giving in the tithe boxes at the back as you leave, or by giving online. And now we will say our declaration. Lord, today by faith, we declare that we are walking in the manifestation season. As your faithful remnant, we will house your very presence. We are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, and he has delivered us from all of our troubles and fears. We are no longer victims, but we are victors in Christ. We will not be deceived by the lies of the enemy, but we will give health, healing, and wholeness to the hopeless and those in despair. We will live under your anointing and see the revealed purpose of Christ in each of our lives. We declare your everlasting word on earth as it is in heaven. Now Carla Johnson is coming to pray.
Good morning, everyone. Would you bow your heads and pray, please? Lord, we just thank you that we can come to your house, that we can be a family together. Lord, we thank you for all that you plan to do here today, because it is your plan, not ours. Lord, I ask that you would just bless the pastor as he brings the word. Bless this worship team as they bring the offering that she talked about today. They were talking back there today about bringing that offering to you. And Lord, we just bring our offering of worship to you. Lord, I ask that if there's anyone here that does not know you, or that is struggling to know you, or that has known you for a long time but feels weaker today, Lord, I ask that you would just lift them up. Lord, that you would bring them front, just their spirit man would just come forward. Lord, that would be superseding over their flesh man. Lord, I just ask for your presence. You're already here. I feel it. I know you're here. Help us to walk up to you and meet you where you're at. We always pray for you to come, for your presence to be here, but it's here. Help us to walk forward, that we would just come forward to what you have for us today. Lord, that we would come boldly to the throne, that we would come boldly to you, because you're waiting and we're ready. And we just thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Chosen, we are the living.
is Sunday and those wives are coming back. Grandpas, grandmas, all that. Yeah, we have a few missing, but you know, they went to the ladies' retreat, and we have some men missing as well. They went to the Stronger Men's Conference in Springfield. I just hope they come back refreshed and everything like that, but I'm sure you're hoping they come back refreshed as well. But anyway, worship with us again.
So I won't be shaken, and 'cause my God is faithful. Every promise is true.
You say that I'm with you.
him out today. Come on, raise your hands and praise him. Oh, he is good. He is worthy. We've all witnessed it. We've all seen his power and his glory and his might. We just got to go and tell everyone. We got to go to the world. That's what these banners say. Let's go and tell the whole world about Jesus. Time is short. The signs of the times are here, of course. You just have a moment to tell your family, tell your friends about God's goodness. I've witnessed your faithfulness. I've seen you breathe life within. So I'll pour out my praise again. You're worthy, God, you're worthy of all of it. And your promises never fail. I've got stories I'll live to tell. So I'll pour out my praise again. You're worthy.
Come on, let's pour out our praise again. Let's sing it again. I've witnessed.
I've witnessed your faithfulness.
I've seen
you breathe life within. So I'll pour out my praise again.
You're worthy,
God, you're worthy of all.
Your promises never fail.
Your promises never fail.
I've got stories
I live to tell.
So I'll
pour out.
Yes, would you clap your hands? Would you lift your voices one more time? If you've experienced the faithfulness of our God, He is good. Have you witnessed it this morning? Maybe your neighbor needs to see your faith this morning. Would you one more time just tell him He's good? Pastor's text this morning is Mark 12:28-34. As they put that on the screen, I had an injury in my wrist. I broke it twice over a 10-year span. And when rain would come, it would swell up real big. And I talked to some physical therapists about it. I didn't go to the doctor because I'm stubborn. I'm sorry if you're a doctor out there. I love you. But I'm a stubborn man. I'm working on that. And I would just not come into agreement with that, and I would just pray over it myself. I would just say, Lord, would you take this away? I just want to testify this morning for some reason. It's been this way for a few months now, but I haven't had pain in my wrist in months. It's rained many, many times. It's not swelled up. I just want to praise God for that. And I just want that faith to stir in you. Maybe you have something that's just nagging you. Maybe it's on the inside. Maybe it's an injury. Maybe it's pain you've dealt with all your life. I just want you to know that God's faithful and He doesn't have to heal you, but He will, and He is good. I just felt like I need to share that as we open the Word of God this morning. I just want to testify of His goodness. Mark 12:28-34. Who's expecting the Lord to speak this morning? I know I am. Mark 12:28-34. And one of the scribes came, and having heard them reasoning together and perceiving that he had answered them well, asked him, which is the first commandment of all? And Jesus answered him, the first of all the commandments is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, and with all strength. And this is the first commandment. And the second is like it, namely this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is none other commandment greater than these. And the scribe said unto him, well, Master, thou hast said the truth, for there is one God, and there is none other but He. And to love Him with all the heart, and with all the understanding, and the strength, and to love his neighbor as himself is more than all burnt offerings and sacrifices. And when Jesus saw that he had answered discreetly, he said unto him, thou art not far from the kingdom of God. And no man after that durst ask him any questions. Will you bow your heads in this place with me? Lord, we are ready to hear from you. We come expecting you to do what you want. And I just pray in these moments that there just be the person of Jesus be revealed and be exalted in this moment, in this house, in this sermon. You are drawing men to yourself. Lord, I pray you'd help our pastor just pour out the word this morning with freedom and boldness and power. And let your oil drip from heaven. In the name of Jesus, we ask these things. Amen and amen.
God bless you. You may be seated this morning. Good to see everybody in the house of the Lord. Danny, if you could give me plenty of volume this morning. I got a chest cold. I don't have much air. Our message is going to be a little bit different than normal, my normal way of preaching. I'm going to do more of a teaching this morning than I am a preaching. The Lord has laid something very heavy in my heart. And I just want to talk to you before I get into the message this morning. I want to tell you the message is so heavy, and the Lord visited with me so heavily about it that I can't even hardly almost start talking about it, but I want to begin to cry, because there's one thing I know is that God has set some people up here today because he loves you. You're not here by coincidence, you're not here by chance, you're here by divine appointment. I know we've got about 80 some people gone with the different ladies retreat and the men's conference, but you know God's got exactly who he wants here today, and that's you. He's brought you here to hear a message of divine truth. There's 2,000 of people here today. There's just people coming in, and you're near the shores of home. You really want to be saved, but you don't even know how to be saved. You're just kind of coming in wanting to adapt. You're just kind of wanting to come in and, you know, just fit in. And there are others that are here that have had the fire but have lost the fire. And God wants to minister to both of you here today. And I don't want you to be afraid to respond to the presence of the Lord. If you feel the Holy Spirit pulling at you right now, now's the time to come to the altar and receive Christ, to be refreshed, to be renewed. And right in the middle of the preaching, you'll not hurt anything if you feel the draw of the Holy Spirit just obeying. Because the minute that you step out in obedience, God begins to do something marvelous in your life. And God can do more than 1 second than I can do in a lifetime of preaching and teaching. And so I want you to hear the word of the Lord as we begin to get into it, and I want you to respond to it. I want you to do more than just hear it. I want you to take it into the depth of your heart and really allow the Holy Spirit to minister to you today. This is very heavy upon me. I've entitled this message, "So Near But Yet So Far Away," and I don't usually give it a title, but that's what the Lord laid in my heart. We see prior to our text that the Sadducees came to Jesus and asked a question. And they were trying to trick him, which they were always trying to do. As you all know, that the Sadducees was a religious group that was constantly battling Christ, fighting against him, trying to trick him up, trying to mess him up. And they come and they ask a question. They said, "Master, Moses wrote unto us, if a man's brother die and leave his wife behind and leave no children, that his brother should take his wife and raise seed unto his brother. Now therefore there were 7 brothers, and the first took a wife, dying and left no seed. And the second took her and died, neither leaving any seed, and the third likewise. And all of the 7 had her and left no seed. Last of all, the woman died also. And in the resurrection, therefore, when they shall rise, whose wife shall she be of them? For the 7 had her a wife." Now, I don't believe that this really happened. I believe that these guys were ridiculous in their statement, but nevertheless, Jesus just answers them. And listen to what he says. "And Jesus answered, said to them, Do ye not therefore err, because you do not know the scriptures, neither the power of God?" How would you like to be rebuked like that? "For when they shall rise from the dead, they neither marry or given in marriage, but they are like the angels which are in heaven." And then we see that Jesus goes on in that chapter and expounds on the things concerning the dead. The Sadducees and their attempt to try to trick him, they really messed up. It backfired on them, because now they've opened themselves up for a message, and he's preaching about the resurrection of the dead, in which the Sadducees did not even believe in. And here they are trying to trick him, and he turns it on them, and he gives them a biblical truth about what the resurrection was all about. And then we see in our text that Jesus then is approached by this scribe within our text. And the reason for this question from the scribe, he's asking him a question, was because he heard that Jesus was responding to the Sadducees, and he perceived that Jesus had answered them well. In other words, he's seen what took place, and he got to thinking, man, did not the Sadducees get set in their place? Did not Jesus turn the tables on them? Did not Jesus give them some real relative truth? And he was impressed by the way that Jesus had handled himself, because he handled himself discreetly and wisely. Notice that the scribe had spiritual perception, which is very important. He not only liked the answer that Jesus gave, but actually he even agreed with what Jesus had said. His question was, which is the first commandment of all? And Jesus answers him and says in verse 19 through 31, the first of all the commandments is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. And the second is like it, namely this, that thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There's none other commandment greater than this. So the scribes asking this question, and Jesus answers it. Now listen to the response. Jesus answered. Now the scribe is fixing to respond back to Christ. He says, and the scribe said unto him, well, master, thou hast said the truth, for there is one God, and there is none other but he. And to love him with all thy heart, with all thy understanding, with all thy soul, with all thy strength, and to love thy neighbor as himself is more than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifice. Now listen to Jesus' response again. And when Jesus saw that, he answered discreetly and said unto him, thou art not far from the kingdom of God. And no man after that dressed asked Jesus any more questions. Notice the words that Jesus gave to this scribe who had some divine enlightenment. He says, thou art not far from the kingdom of God. And notice the scribe spoke practically and sensibly and without prejudice, as Christ expressed it, that the scribe even spoke discreetly. And there's a great indication that the scribe was nearing the shores of truth by his knowledge and by his response and his agreeing with Jesus. The scribe recognized the ceremonies of the Jewish church inferior to the great principles of truth and love. He said to love him with all your heart and with all your understanding, with all your soul, with all thy strength, and to love his neighbor as himself is more than all of the whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. He said that the Jewish ceremonies is lesser than the biblical truth of what Jesus said. The scribe had come to the knowledge of true religion, which was to love God and to love man. And the scribe had it in his head, but the real question is, did he really have it in his heart? To have head knowledge without having it in your heart is the same as not having it at all. Can I have an amen? Jesus looks at him and says, thou art not far from the kingdom of God. In other words, you're real close. You're almost there with what you've said. The revelation that you've given is showing me that you're near the kingdom of God. Salvation, folks, is more than the correctness of the intellect. It is a life-giving principle that literally regulates the will of man. It's more than just having a head knowledge of it. It's actually learning how to live it out and put it into practice in daily living. It's living it out in everyday life. We are to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. But notice something very strange that we don't catch within this context of Jesus and the scribes' discussion. First of all, when Jesus said, this is the first commandment, and it begins to start, it says, love the Lord thy God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Well, when the scribe repeated it, he added something to it that we don't see. And the scribe said, yeah, you're to love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your understanding. Jesus never told us to love him with all of our understanding. And matter of fact, that's the problem sometimes with the church. We're too analytical and we think that we have to try to understand everything to accept everything. Come on, somebody. And this was the problem with the scribe. He had a certain amount of enlightenment, but he didn't have enough to push him over into the true reality because he tried to understand the workings of God. And how many knows if you can understand God, then he's too little to be your God? Because God, his thoughts are above our thoughts. His ways are above ours. His ways are past understanding. And can I tell you, you know what Proverbs says? Proverbs tells us in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 4 through 5, to trust in the Lord with all your heart and to lean not unto your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him and he shall direct thy path. Be not wise in your own eyes, but he said, fear the Lord and depart from evil. Being wise in your own understanding and your own enlightenment and your own theology and your own intellect, he said, is evil. It's called human secularism. Come on, somebody. And that we are not to try to understand everything before we embrace the truth and the reality of who God is and what God can do. Can I have an amen in the house? And can I tell you, there's a lot of things about the kingdom of God that I don't understand. I don't understand that the last shall be first. I don't understand that when someone smacks me on the right cheek, I'm to turn the left also. I don't understand that. Come on, somebody. I don't understand to pray and to love those that despitefully use me and abuse me. I don't understand that. Let's go to war with them. I don't understand. In order to find my life, I got to lose it. Amen. How many understand those principles? How many understand the principles you got to give to get? You got to believe in the unseen. How many has a problem sometimes believing in the unseen? I know that I do. I don't understand everything about the Trinity. I don't understand everything about the sovereignty of God. I don't understand everything about the majesticness of God. Come on, somebody. There's a lot of things that I don't understand about God, but I believe in every principle that he's ever said, and I believe the word of God at its face value. I don't have to understand it to embrace the reality of that truth. All I got to do is accept him and trust. His ways are above my ways, and he's looking out for my betterment no matter what happens. Amen. 1 John 2:4-5 says, he that saith, I know him and keepeth not his commandments is a liar, and the truth ain't in him. That's hard. But listen to verse 5. But whosoever keepeth his words, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby we know that we are in him. One of the things you've got to understand, that scripture just said that living it out is the proof that we know him. The reality of me living out the gospel in my life, not understanding the full application of it, but me just trusting in the unseen hand of God and the knowledge of God for my life is proof and evidence that I've had an encounter with God. It is the fruit and the evidence and the proof that I am in him and he's in me. Jesus said in John 15:14, you are my friends if you do whatsoever I command you. How many wants to be the friend of God? Then be obedient to God. Amen. James wrote in James 1:22, but be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. He said, when you hear the word of God, don't just agree with it. Don't just like it. Don't just enjoy it. And don't just amen it. He said, don't be a hearer only, but be a doer of it. Because if you're not a doer of it, you're deceiving yourselves. In other words, you can literally agree with something and still not allow it to govern you and regulate you. And you're still lost, even though you're in agreement with what you said. This scribe was in agreement with Jesus. He was in agreement about the commandments. He even says there's only one Lord. He's making confessions. And Jesus still looks at him and said, but you're not quite there yet. You've not quite entered in yet. All of these scriptures reveal how there could be great knowledge of truth and yet that truth not reach the depth of the inner man, the soul, the spirit. There's a great cause for every one of us here this morning to diligently try and examine our knowledge and faith in Christ and to see whether it be true and sound and sincere or whether it be hypocritical and counterfeit faith, because it may be one of us here today that is not far from the kingdom of God. So close, but yet so far away. Not quite in, it's the same as being out. Not quite saved, it's still being lost. Oh Lord, Moses got so close to entering into Canaan. It's one of the saddest stories of the Old Testament. A man that led the children of Israel out of Egypt's bondage and went through so much and trying to honor God in the middle of the wilderness. He disobeys God and he strikes a rock when he should have spoke to it. As a result of that disobedience, he was not able to enter into the promised land. He was forfeited of that right. And one of the saddest things is that Moses got right to the brink of taking them over and fulfilling his role as a leader. And because of that disobedience, he died with Canaan in his eyesight. So close, but yet so far away. It's heavy in here today. It was King Agrippa that told Paul in Acts 26:28, then Agrippa said unto Paul, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. And I think about what's going on in the mind of Agrippa today. As he went out in eternity after he died, and those haunting words, almost, you persuaded me to be a Christian, Paul. In other words, Agrippa was saying, Paul, you presented your case well. I seen your passion. I heard your presentation. You sold me on your narrative. You've almost persuaded me. I almost accepted. So close, but yet so far away. One of the things that has bothered me for years and years and years, I hope you never have to experience this, and I hope I never have to experience anything like it again. I remember one time another member and I met with a young man who was distraught over a certain life situation. We talked to him one Saturday morning for hours. Tears coming down his cheeks. Conviction was all over him. He felt our love. He felt our passion. He knew we were real. He knew we cared. He understood everything we were saying and even agreed with everything that we were talking about. We began to tell him the biblical principles and we began to quote scripture and we do everything we knew to do. And he'd say, yeah, yeah, I know. And he'd wring his hands and he'd wipe his tears and he would kick his feet. And he understood what he needed to do, but he couldn't muster up just to do it. For hours we sat and talked and shared and begged and cried and prayed and done everything that we needed to do, but we couldn't get him to make a choice to surrender and repent and to give his heart and life to Jesus Christ. The next day he went out and committed suicide. That's ate me up for years. And I thought to myself, what if I'd prayed a little longer? What if I would just have maybe presented the gospel a little better? What if I'd tarried just a little longer? What if? Oh, it's ate me up for years and years and years. The next day he commits to suicide, so close me, yet so far away, at the edge but wouldn't break over, in the threshold but wouldn't go in. He stared at the shores of truth, but he ignored it and rejected it, and he was lost. It's like another story I'll be relating to hopefully at the end of this sermon. There's all kinds of that happening in the body of Christ. I guess Spurgeon was right when he said, some gaze at the gate of heaven, but yet they still drive to hell. Christianity is more than praying a little prayer. It's more than just believing a biblical truth. Christianity is more than coming to a knowledge of something till you feel good about it, but it's a reformed life in Jesus Christ. Can I have an amen? 1 Corinthians 5:17, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things are passed away and all things are becoming. Doesn't mean he's perfect, but his heart has changed. What he once loved, he hates. What he once hated, he loves. And there may be struggle, I'm not saying that. Salvation is more than information, it's transformational. It's a transformed life by the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. It's a work of regeneration being made new. It's a work of justification being set free just as if I've never sinned. Oh, Holy Spirit, help me here this morning. Paul said in Romans 12:1-2, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Be not conformed to the world, but be you transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what's that good and acceptable, perfect will of God. Did you know that one can have a religious knowledge, an accurate creed, and even have an acquaintance with biblical knowledge without the will being influenced and the affections being purified and the life and the conversation being regulated? There's too much of what Randy West calls just street religion, where somebody gets a breakthrough with an experience with Christ. And it is an experience, it's an encounter where they overcome a drug problem. And all of a sudden they're filling the pulpits all over America, but they're still living in adultery, and they're still cussing like a sailor, and they're still having all these other things. But because they had some kind of one breakthrough in their life, come on, somebody. So close, but yet not in. It's also being taught and being raised in no sound truth is not the same as becoming to a believing faith produced by that truth where we live it out. You can be sound in doctrine. You can have a head knowledge and still be void of transformation in your life. As Mary Ruth Stone said in a Florida camp meeting, you can be straight as a gum barrel, but just as empty. Salvation is a thing of the heart. It's not just a thing of the head. It's not what you know, it's who you know that's important. Christianity isn't something you come in and adapt to. Come on, it's not something you come in and catch. Come on, it's not something you come in and hear and just think, well, I'm gonna adapt to the surroundings. I'm gonna fit in. I like the place. I'm attracted to the place. I wanna fit in. I'm just gonna come in. I'm gonna be a good person. I'm gonna change my world. That's not Christianity. The scribe was right within his creed, but it's possible to know the right creed and still not know the Christ. A man is not necessarily in the kingdom of God because he knows the truth. When he hears it, it's whether or not he answers that truth and applies that truth. One can even agree with the truth and still be unregulated and ungoverned by that truth. Amen? I'm concerned that there's many that are remaining near to salvation without ever entering in, staring at the gate, but standing outside, having the invitation, come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Having the invitation, come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest in your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burdens light. Having the invitation, whosoever will come unto me, I will in no wise cast out. Having the invitation, whosoever athirst, let him come, and let him drink of the water of life. We could go on to the invitations of Jesus. Having the invitation, but not yet totally accepting it. Standing on the edge, but not taking that leap. So close, but yet so far away, trying to work it out, trying to adapt, trying to match up, trying to fit in is not good enough. Can I have an amen? How many feel the Holy Spirit in this place? He's at work right now. Hearts are being touched. I know what it's like to be in a congregation of a little church at Dudley and the Holy Spirit come and say, kid, I want you. Raised from a moral home, a moral family. My dad would never lie. My dad would never cheat. My dad would never steal. My dad was a man of great moral character. But me, him, my mom, my grandma, all of us had to make a way to an old cross, wooden altar representing the kneeling down at the cross of Jesus. And we had to repent of our sins and accept him as Lord and Savior. And it was there a transformational work happened in my life. Did I become perfect overnight? No, but my heart was touched by a burning fire of the Holy Spirit. And I know my salvation's real. His spirit bears witness with my spirit that I am a child of God. Holy Spirit. Many find the message of Christ's truth profitable. Yeah, that's the way to live. That's a good life. Yeah, I'm attracted to that. But really never going to know Jesus. They're spectators instead of participators. They look and wonder and they take bits and pieces. They take what they like throughout the rest. There was a ship that went down in Moffray Bay on the coast of Wales. There was a woman that was married to one of the officers in the boat. They come to her house that was on the bay, overlooking the bay. And they knocked on the door and she opened the door and said, I'm sorry to inform you that the ship has went down out here in the bay and your husband has drowned. And this was her words, so near home, yet lost. He drowned within eye distance of his home. He seen the light in the shores of his home, and yet he was lost. You know what they say? They say that the average person killed in a car automobile accident is within 5 miles of their home. So near, and yet so far away. There's so many that's like the foolish virgins of Matthew 25, and I don't know if I need to go here. I feel a compelling of the Holy Spirit right now. That God wants to just reach down and really do a wonderful work of grace in your life. There's some of you that's come here with great intentions. You love this place. You love me. You love the worship. You're really adapting well, but you need more than just to adapt to an atmosphere. You need to come and know the Christ. You need to come and know Jesus. Amen. But they're foolish virgins. They were so close in that they were virgins. They all had lamps symbolic of divine enlightenment. They were just like the scribe. The scribe had divine enlightenment. There was a certain amount of revelation that God was giving. You can't even come to Christ without the Holy Spirit drawing you. That's divine enlightenment. Some of you right now, the Holy Spirit is ministering to you. He's given you divine enlightenment. He's coming. He loves you so much. He set this service up so that you could respond to him in obedience here today. Some say that these foolish virgins never had any oil because they never brought anything with them. But verse 8 says, and the foolish said unto the wise, give us of your oil, for our lamps have gone out. Notice that these lamps had gone out. At one time, they had enlightenment, but they allowed that enlightenment to get dim and die out. That God contends with us for a season. Repentance is a gift of God. It's not just something we turn on and turn off. It's not just something, well, I think I'll get saved today. No. You wouldn't even have a desire to be saved if it wasn't for the Holy Spirit contending with you. And there's times that you're ripe. You're ready to be picked off the vine. And that time is now. Now is the day of salvation. It's a time of now. God is pleading with someone because there comes time, if you're not careful, that divine enlightenment will fade off and God will no longer contend with you for a season. And in that season, you're lost with no hope. Can I have an amen? These foolish virgins were close in the sense that they went out to even meet the bridegroom. They had some sound knowledge. They had knowledge of the bridegroom and they also had regard for him because we see their desire to go forth to meet him. As he come after his bride, there was a part of them that desired to know Jesus in an intimate way. There was a part of them that had an affection about him, that wanted to see him, to wanted to know him, but they never pushed through to really come to know him. They had gone so far to meet him and had made professions of their faith, but they lost the real sincerity and persevering of their faith by not holding fast to their commitment and their profession. They once were enlightened, but now their fires went out. Thinking they would meet him, but was rejected. So close, but yet so far away. Aware that he was coming, but still lost. There's many here in this building today that know Jesus is coming back again. Amen? But the question is, are we ready? Look at the knowledge they had. They were looking for his appearance, yet not ready when he came. They had understanding, but no spiritual readiness. That's why the Bible says, be ye ready, for you know not the day or the hour when the Son of Man cometh. Their religion did not go down to the lowest depths of nature. It was a thing of the surface. And can I tell you, it was a thing of the head and not a thing of the heart. The most miserable person in the world is the one that has knowledge of what they need to do, but never find the will to be able to do it. There was no root in themselves. Their seed fell on rocky ground where there was not much earth, and the cares of life sprung up and choked the word, and they become unfruitful, according to Matthew 13. They were close in the sense that they knew what it took to be ready. They were not ignorant of his provision. They knew they had to be saved. They knew they had to have oil. They knew they had to have the Holy Spirit. But they wanted it at the expense of someone else. They didn't want to apply themselves to get their own. They were just simply satisfied, content, and lukewarm where they were at, and they were uncommitted. They trusted their whole lives on the hopes of others, their prayers, their sacrifice, their faith, their spiritual power to see them through. Because listen to what they said, give us of your oil. We don't want to get our own. You pray for us. You counsel us through. You sacrifice your time. Come on. Your mama ain't gonna be able to pray you through to heaven. She can pray through a lot of things, but when it comes down to it, you and Jesus are gonna stand alone. There's a lot of things the church can do. We can pray, we can fast, we can intercede, we can love you, we can do everything we know to do, but that will not be good enough if you don't come to find him for yourself. Can I have an amen? I think I better just quit. There's a story where Jesus is teaching his disciples about offense. And one of the things that he says really got my attention. He just looked at them and he said, remember Lot's wife. Come on, somebody. I'm torn to where to go here. I think I'm going to skip all this, though it's good. It's very, very good. Remember Lot's wife, he says. Jesus was teaching his disciples to avoid the occasion of offense, and he said, just simple, remember Lot's wife. She was to be the example of the life of the uncommitted and the life of the disobedient. The example of Lot's wife was recorded only for the purpose of warning. She wasn't lost like millions of other people who had never been enlightened, but she perished in the midst of divine deliverance. So close, but yet so far away, near is not in. She was lost while literally being brought out. She was lost in transit. As the old saying says, close only applies in horseshoes and hand grenades, but it don't apply in the kingdom of God. Lot's wife chose the road backward in the midst of her pilgrimage. She was lost in the middle of transition. Just like Adam being placed in paradise, but the door to the outside provision was left open. So he went out by his own choice. And Luke 9 and 62, it says, and Jesus said, no man putting his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. Lot's wife was almost saved, but she was lost in that transition. The burning city was behind her. She had been thrust out by the hand of an. She had an encounter of deliverance. There are many that are having these encounters and they're having these experiences, and there are these street people that get up and they are delivered from a certain drug or alcohol or whatever. She had divine warning. She had seen the wicked punished. But even with the warning and the example before and being thrust out by an angel, she acted in contempt of that warning, disregarded the command, and with the chosen refuge not far inside, I want to tell you, she was lost. So close, but yet so far away. There's people that will come to an altar, and God will do a marvelous work in their heart, and they'll get up and still walk away with not totally surrendered to the Lordship of Jesus. Come on. Right in the middle of their deliverance, they can shut down on you. I've seen it time after time as a pastor, where people come up and they want to be saved, and you're agonizing with them. And you're praying them through and everything's going good, and all of a sudden you just come to a wall and you feel it and you know it, and you fight for them and you contend with them. You love them, you cry, you counsel, you give them scripture, but it's like they come to a certain place and they just stop. So close, but yet so far away. In closing, there was an elderly black lady who was a very spiritual, godly mother who had prayed miracles for her son and grandchildren. A powerful, powerful woman of God. Things would happen in their family, go get grandma, go get mom. Mom would come and she would operate in the Holy Spirit, and things would happen in that family. It was unbelievable. And one day she found out that her son was what they call a kingpin in running drugs. And he was making all kinds of money, and he had lied to her and made her believe a lie that he had this great job where he traveled and he was doing some kinds of sales for a big company, and he bought her houses and cars, and they'd moved out of the ghetto and they moved into these nice luxurious places. And through the grapevine, she had heard where he got the money and she had heard what had taken place. She pulled him inside and began to tell him, son, you know better than this. And conviction fell on the boy. He said, I know, mama, I know. I'm caught in a trap. No, you're not caught in no trap, because God can deliver you of the trap just like that. Amen. And she's pouring into this boy, and he knows everything. Just like I know a man. He can quote the scripture better than you can. You don't want to bait the scripture with him. He knows it inside and out, been raised in the church. And I want to tell you, he's got all of the biblical knowledge in his head, but it is evident that he don't know the Christ, because there's no fruit. There is no evidences of him knowing, because he's not living out what he knows. And this boy had it all up here, being raised in it all of his life, seeing the miracles, seeing all of the things that happened in that family, seeing how mama prayed him through. And he kept putting trust in that. And finally he said, "Mama, you don't understand. If it wasn't for this job, you wouldn't be living in this house." She said, "You put me back over in Gas Street in the ghetto. I don't care. This ain't worth it, son." And she began to preach to him. And finally said, "Okay, Mama, I'll make you a commitment. I'm gonna make one more run. And after that run, it's over." And she said, "No, you're not." And she begged him, and he just could not want to make that big money. It was an opportunity of a lifetime to make more money than he's ever made in his life. And he makes this choice. "One more and it's over, I promise. I'll go to church, I'll do right." She said, "Son, you don't understand. You can't bargain with God. God's after you right now. Not tomorrow, not the next day, but right now, son." Well, Mama just prayed for me. She said, "I fear my prayer won't do no good. It's time you pray." He went out with her weeping and wailing and interceding and praying and begging and following him to the car and pulling at his clothes. He finally gets in and finally manages to get the door shut, roll up the window and lock the door. As he's going down the road, she's running behind the car, begging him, "Don't do this, don't do this." That night he done it, and he got a bullet in the head and was killed. So close, but yet so far away. Would you stand with me this morning? There's not a person in this building that isn't for you here today. We're all for you. I'm for you. Christianity isn't a bunch of rules you adapt to. It's not cleaning yourself up. It's not coming in and fitting in. It's not coming in and being attracted. It's not just liking certain things. It's life transformation, where you come to know Jesus and his law and his principles govern your heart, and you walk it out to the best of your ability in fear and trembling. With every eye closed and every head bowed here this morning, if you find in yourself wavering a little, or if you find yourself, you've really never really been converted. You like the church, you like everything about it. You're attracted, you're here today. And I believe God even had me to preach this because we got a low attendance today and it's a lot easier to get out of the pews. God's made provision for you. I just want you to step out. Some have already came. Some have felt that in their spirit. Now I want you to just step out and start coming. Please don't be like the kingpin. Please don't be like Lot's wife. Please don't be the one that drowns in the bay so close to home but yet so far away. Is there any others? Thank the Lord for those that's responding here today. God loves you this morning. You know what I feel? I feel the same spirit that I felt that night or that morning when I was begging that guy, "Please accept Jesus." I'm begging some of you here today, don't put me through this again to where I find out that you never really committed, but in a few days your life snipped out and you're lost. But yet you were so close by hearing this message. You were right there. Almost ready to make the decision, almost ready to make the step, but you wouldn't take it. The opportunity and the availability is here right now for you to have eternal life through Jesus and Jesus alone. It's not knowing about the church. It's not having your name on a roll book. "Well, I'm a member." I don't care. It's whether or not your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. It's knowing him. Paul said, "That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings. I know who I have believed in, and I am persuaded that he's able to keep that which I've committed to him against that day." I know him. It's a person you got to come to know. It's not about rules or regulations. It's about relationship with Jesus. Is there any others this morning? Any others this morning? Some are just renewing their vows. They're just renewing themselves. Right now, oh Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, help us today. I know I've obeyed the Spirit of the Lord here today.
Come out of hiding, you're safe here with me.
I know that the Holy Spirit's contending with you. I still feel it. Saints, would you pray with me? This is a sobering moment right now. Some people are weighing the balances. They're right there. They're near the shores of truth. They're right at the threshold.
You've got your
so close.
And I hold.
They're in the ship at the bay, but they need to be brought on home.
You've been.
Is there any others here today?
And I hold.
I know it's a heavy word. I know it's a different kind of a word than what I preach. But I know that God loves you enough to send it to you here this morning. Come on, that's a way. I feel the releasing as people are coming through the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. There'll be people here to pray with you and love on you.
That I was thinking of
when you get up from here today, there's going to be new names written in the Lamb's Book of Life. There's going to be people saved by the power and the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Another one's going to be free from Satan's grip. Can I have an amen? The devil's a liar. He's lost. Jesus is a conqueror. He's got all victory for everyone in this building. Is there anybody else here this morning? We're going to pray with ease and love on these people. Come on, I feel it. There's still some really, really struggling. Pulling at you. There's an elderly man, not old, middle age. You're feeling it. You're feeling the effects. God's calling you. God's calling you. Come on. Step out. I'm waiting on that one person because I can almost put my finger on you. I want to be the first one to embrace you. Welcome you home. Come on.
You knew what was.
I want to contend just a little longer. I don't want regrets. I don't want to live with things on my shoulders. I didn't get my best.
I was thinking of.
I want you to know I love you.
From the grave.
Will you step out right now? Come on. You're saying you're putting pressure. No, it's the Holy Ghost. Just put the pressure. I'm just a vessel in obedience to God here today. It's not about your words. It's not about all that you do for the kingdom. There's even going to be people say, have we not prophesied in your name? Have we not done these mighty works in your name? And Jesus is going to say, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I really never knew you. You did not. I don't know you.
Oh, keep coming. Oh, just keep.
Is there any others here this morning? I know this is a long altar call, and I usually don't do this, but I feel the pressure of the Holy Spirit. Come on, I'm waiting on one individual for sure that I know of. It's not responded yet. The Lord's revealed it to me. You're really struggling here. If I knew it wouldn't offend you, I'd come back and get you, but I will not do that. You have to make the choice on your own. But when you come, I'll meet you here, I promise you. Will you come?
Will only become.
Will you come?
Part of the story.
Come on.
As you run.
We're all being challenged. We're all trying to think it through.
Will only become part of.
Is there any others? People are just renewing themselves and making sure, some of them, which is a smart thing. Saying, Lord, let the fire burn on me again.
Cause baby, you're almost home now.
Leave. Oh, what a sobering move of the Holy Spirit. Somebody here that has told somebody just here recently, man, I like that church. I'm reading your mail right now because you've told people, I like that preacher. You're saying, man, I like those people. Man, I really found me a place at home. That's what you've told them. But I want to tell you, you're going to even like it more when you come to know the Christ of the church. When you come to know the real person of the church. Would you come? Your salvation in the synagogue, in the church, in the assembly of God, creed of the church of God, doctrine, or in the Baptist faith. Your salvation's in Jesus Christ and Him alone. Is there any others this morning? The one I'm thinking of has not responded yet. And I'm not going to keep just badgering. I just want you, just for a moment as we pray, to get in a spirit of worship with the Lord and pray over the service. And pray for people to have real life-changing experiences here today. To when they get up, that God's Spirit will bear witness with their spirit that they're children of God. And they know that they know that they know. And those of you that feel like coming, you can still come and we'll meet you here in Jesus' name.
You've been on lockdown, but I hold the key. 'Cause I loved you before, you knew what was love, and I saw it all, still I chose the cross. You were the one that I was thinking of when I rose from the grave. Now rid of the shackles, my victory's yours. I tore the veil for you to come close. There's no reason to stay at a distance anymore. You're not far from home. And I'll be your lighthouse when you're lost at sea.
Sinner that repenteth. Can you give the Lord praise in this house this morning? Oh, come on. We got to give Him higher praise for that. Yeah, come on, a little louder. Let heaven know we're in agreement with heaven this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My. may the Lord bless you. And men, may the Lord keep you out of trouble. Get home and clean the house real fast before the lady gets back. May the Lord bless you. God bless you.